Kira and I want to talk to you about an experiment that I have been working on this spring, and it has the working title Wisdom of Select Crowds, an experiment of unsampling predictions. So Wisdom of the Crowds is this phenomenon where you have a large jar of gumballs and then you go around asking people how many gumballs are in the jar, and then by magic it turns out that averaging or looking at the median of the answers, you actually come quite close to the true number of gumballs in the jars. It was introduced into the scientific community by Sir Francis Galton back in 1907, where he was attending the West England Fat Stock and Poultry Exhibition. And he asked passbyers the weight of an ox. And then he did a paper that was published approximately 40 years later in Nature, where he showed that the median of the answers was extremely close to the true value. So the concept of wisdom of the crowds has naturally been occurring in a lot of different scientific shades, you can say. And as I was reading articles, I came across different articles on this subject, and I was waiting for my data to arrive, so I figured why not just collect some data myself. And I wanted to do an exploratory study, and I wanted to see, well, does many hands then make tighter works, and how? How many samples do I need? If I only look at not just passbyers in the zoo asking to see how much the elephant weighs, but people who are actually experts in the fields, maybe I will not need so many experts. And could I also come up with some strategies for sampling? How could I select my experts based on specific measurable factors that I could find? So it's very exploratory. So the first thing, first problem you run into is how do I get a lot of people to do a lot of work for me, spend their time working for me. And a very good thing to do is to ask someone who can't say no. And we're at a university and there are a lot of students and they go to courses, and in courses they have to do assignments. So I teamed up with my supervisor who has this course in computational data analysis. And in order to attend the exam, the students have to hand in, and that's not new just because I joined, but they have to hand in an assignment where they do a predictive model. So I build up my collection of data on that exercise they were already doing. And then I tried to make it a little bit difficult for them. So I simulated 100 observations of 100 covariates, and I gave them the response, and then I wanted them to build this predictive model, and I messed a little with the data, taking out observations to mimic a missingness in data and correlation structures, and you have it to make it seeming real data-like. Okay, and then I asked them to hand in three things. So I wanted them to give me the predictions on 1,000 new observations. That's a vector of 1,000 predictions. I wanted them to evaluate their own method. I wanted them to come up with a measure of loss on their own predictions. And then I wanted them to answer a questionnaire with different assessments, self-assessment measures that I hoped I could use for building my sampling strategy. So how difficult they thought the exercise was, how much time they spent, etc., things like that, that were kind of qualitative but measured in a very quantitative scale. Okay, so then I got my data about a month ago, and then I looked at it, and the first thing I plotted, of course, was, well, how did they say they perform, and how did they actually perform? And I was very surprised to see this plot. So what we have here is a few points we should note, the first one being that virtually 54 groups out of 55 groups overestimated their own performance, some quite heavily, actually. That's the first thing, quite surprising also. There seems to be no real correlation between how they performed and how they thought they performed. The other thing is, the lack of correlation is quite interesting. That they all overestimate is also interesting. And then this outlier popped up, which was quite annoying to start with, but you know, they're always there. So maybe it's for the better that I had to handle this outlier. So I started doing my unsampling strategy, the first one being not so sophisticated, just unsampling by random. So I just selected at random two groups, averaged out the predictions, and then calculated their loss at this root mean squared error. And what you can see in this plot, where the first box plot is just the data that I observed the individuals, then unsampling 2, 3 up to 6, is there is definitely something is getting better when I unsample, but maybe I shouldn't take more than 3 groups because then I kind of doesn't gain much The variation is lowered, not surprisingly, but this outlier really messes it up, and it gives us these very tall, heavy tails in the box plots. You really don't want to pick a sample where the outlier is in. I tried to ensemble by other strategies based on the root mean squared error predictions they gave me. So first I just split it up into three groups, the ones who said that they did best, medium, and worst, so to speak, relatively speaking. And well, the main conclusion here is one, the ones who say they do best are the ones who do worst. That's the red box plot you see. In every single ensemble, the red box plot is above the other ones. So, and other than that, it really doesn't matter what I do. They're pretty much the same. So none of these strategies are very genius, except stay away from the ones who say they do best. Sampling by other strategies, that would be just picking at random and then taking out the extremes inspired by how they usually do jury grading. You want to take out outliers. Didn't really tell me much else. The green one here is also the strategy where I take away the ones who say they do worst, leaving me with the ones who say they do best, and we already know that that's a bad strategy. So I wasn't really getting anywhere with this, other than doing it by random is fine, or just picking in the middle or the top. So can I use the questionnaires? Can I use how much time they spent? No. Because there is absolutely no correlation between the performance and how much time they spend, how difficult they find the task to be, how well they thought they did relative to the rest of the class, or how they found themselves on a competence level in the class. There's just nothing. And that was like my second big surprise. It's concluding that it's really, really difficult to estimate how your model is actually performing. So what do I have to do now, going forward? I have the reports from all the students, and I have to trawl through them to label all methods. So I want to do a selection strategy based on getting a variety of methods present. I will expect that to do something good for me, I hope. Also, I want to look into the theoretical framework behind it. Can I say something about these strategies and a lower, at least a lower boundary for the, what can I even hope for performance-wise? And then last one, this outlier thing really opened my eyes, so it was annoying that it was there, but it actually was kind of a gift as well, because now I had to think about how to handle it. So doing the selection strategies based on the transformed predictions is probably not the way to go, and I should probably look at the prediction space instead, making sure that I do not include like extreme values in my predictions instead. So that's the things that I'm going to look into going forward. And if anyone has any ideas or comments, they're most welcome. I would very much like to hear from you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Questions? Who has a question?
Yes.
Yes.
In this case, the problem the student solved, did they all do it individually, so they couldn't see what the others did, right?
No, they couldn't see what the others did. They were in groups of two, max two, so individually or in groups of two.
Mm.
Yeah.
So,
I don't know how much they discussed it.
Right.
So.
Do you think it would change it a lot if they could see what they did?
If they could see what each other did?
Yeah.
Well, I was quite inspired by a study where they had sent out this question and data set to 29 different research teams, where they all asked, does skin color has anything to do with the frequency of red cards in soccer matches? And in that study, they did this, they presented their plan for evaluating the data or their analysis plan, then they discussed it, and they gave each other feedback, and they went back home, and then they reevaluated how to do their evaluation, and then they presented their results, and they also ended up with 29 different results. Some quite similar, but also some very different results. So that was also part of my inspiration for this, because I think it's so interesting that you meet, when you do data analysis or data science or statistics, you meet people saying, I have this, I click with the data, can you do the analysis? But it's just a analysis, it's not the analysis. So this humble approach to saying, this is my analysis, but there could be other ways to do it. It becomes very obvious in this that there are very many different ways to doing it. So I'm not sure it would change.
Mm.
Some problem.
So has it affected how you see science? That there isn't just one analysis?
Yeah, I think it's very... I think, I hope I already knew that. But it made it very obvious for me. And also I think it's very important. Especially to people who are not, who are the ones who have the questions and who collect the data, to tell them this is just one way of approaching it. Another way could also be just as good, or not just as good, because then I would have picked that one, but you could argue other ways.
More questions?
How did you outline surfaces? As expert, a medium, or?
You can see it actually in the plot. So here you can see that we expect it to be somewhere like around three or something. Yeah.
So medium.
So medium. Yeah. But I actually contacted them and they had a bad mistake in what they did and they reevaluated it and it came back into the cloud with the rest of them. But we don't know that when we just get the predictions. We don't know which one is the outlier. Especially if we're only asking one person to do it.
I have a final stupid question because we have time. What is it that they had to predict number?
Yeah, it was
what information were they given?
They were given
range?
1,000 variables, some factors, some continuous variables, and it was data that I simulated. So there were no sort of story behind it. It was just what can you tell from data.
And then how can you have a wisdom about something which is not connected to what you do in your... I mean, wisdom of crowds in my mind is something where you have some knowledge maybe from your day-to-day life and you can apply it, but here it was disconnected from what a crowd would normally have as knowledge.
But you have a wisdom in how to approach the data. How do I handle this type of data?
Okay.
So that's the wisdom. But of course, wisdom of crowds is probably best translated into machine learning as ensembling.
Maybe it's your time to give a very brief feedback.
Yeah, just we've given a minute to feedback. So I've selected a few of the many strong points in your presentation, so we can all learn from each other's strengths here. So first of all, thank you for introducing us to your passion for working with the subject, the wisdom of select crowds. One of the things I'd noticed was a strength was the initial story of the crowd from everyday life, asking people just to walk passers-by to assess the number of things that they saw and so on. And that was a nice concrete example from everyday life. If we look at the way that you delivered this, the way that you used your voice, I think you'll have all noticed that that Kira went up and down with her voice here, and that worked really nicely, especially with phrases like, so can I do this, or we're at a university. So involving the audience too, that's very nice. And just a final point, your slides, they work very nicely in combination with what you said. When you put up a slide there where you said, what was it? My first surprise. It was there on screen and you said it with your voice. So that all worked very nicely together. So thank you.
Thank you very much.